Good evening and welcome to this PBS NewsHour special, The End of Roe. I'm Judy Woodruff. The Supreme Court today delivered one of its most consequential decisions in generations, ending the constitutional right to an abortion. The court overturned Roe v. Wade, nearly five decades after an earlier court first guaranteed those rights. The ramifications of this decision are going to be far-reaching. But tonight, we're going to look closely at the court's decision, what will change in many states, and how this will affect women and families around the country. John Yang begins with a report on the decision and the immediate reaction today.
Outside the Supreme Court, jubilation and celebration for some.
My body!
My body!
My choice!
For others, rage coupled with resolve. Today's decision had been much anticipated since early May when Justice Samuel Alito's draft opinion was leaked. The court's ruling ends the constitutional right to an abortion, a right that had been the law of the land for nearly 50 years. Alito wrote the majority opinion, joined by Justices Clarence Thomas, Neil Gorsuch, Brett Kavanaugh, and Amy Coney Barrett. The liberal justices, Stephen Breyer, Sonia Sotomayor, and Elena Kagan, dissented. Chief Justice John Roberts did not join his conservative colleagues in overturning Roe. He said there was no need to do that in order to uphold a 15-week Mississippi abortion ban that was the subject of the case. At the White House, President Biden quickly condemned the decision and urged Congress to act.
The court has done what it has never done before, expressly take away a constitutional right that is so fundamental to so many Americans. That had already been recognized. The court's decision to do so will have real and immediate consequences. The only way we can secure a woman's right to choose, and the balance that existed, is for Congress to restore the protections of Roe v. Wade as federal law.
In a statement, former President Trump called the ruling the biggest win for life in a generation. He went on to take credit for it, saying it was only made possible because I delivered everything as promised. House Speaker Nancy Pelosi weighed in at her weekly news conference.
American women today have less freedom than their mothers. For 50 years, a constitutional right for a woman having the right to choose. The hypocrisy is raging, but the harm is endless.
House Republican leader Kevin McCarthy claimed a win.
The people have won a victory. The right to life has been vindicated. The voiceless will finally have a voice. This great nation can now live up to its core principle that all are created equal, not born equal, created equal.
Today's ruling is likely to lead to abortion bans in about half the states. Some have laws triggered by the overturning of Roe or pre-Roe laws still on the books. Michigan Attorney General Dana Nessel said her state's 1931 law is unenforceable.
In the event that the Court of Appeals or later the Michigan Supreme Court were to overturn that, then the 1931 law would spring back into effect. But as of right now, it is unenforceable. So everything remains the same as it was yesterday at this time, but just for now.
Corporate America also responded. The Walt Disney Company announced it would pay for employees' travel if it was needed to access family planning and reproductive care. Citigroup, JP Morgan Chase, Netflix, and Amazon, among others, had already pledged to offer similar benefits. From overseas, leaders weighed in on the historic ruling. British Prime Minister Boris Johnson.
I think it's a big step backwards. I've always believed in a woman's right to choose, and I stick to that view, and that's why the UK has the laws that it does.
Canadian Prime Minister Justin Trudeau tweeted it was horrific. French Prime Minister Emmanuel Macron wrote, abortion is a fundamental right for all women.
This is what democracy looks like.
As the day wore on, the crowd outside the Supreme Court grew. And across the country, in Detroit, in Boston, in New York, protesters spilled into the streets to decry the end of a long-standing constitutional right. I'm John Yang.
to unpack today's Supreme Court opinion, including its conservative majority and the liberal dissent, we turn now to Marcia Coyle of the National Law Journal. Welcome back to the program, Marcia. This is a big one. Put this in context, though. In the pantheon of major Supreme Court decisions, where does this one fit?
This is huge. I can't even remember when the Supreme Court last revoked a right an American citizen held. And so this one was nearly 50 years old, had also been reaffirmed multiple times.
And rolling the clock back, essentially. Is that right?
Absolutely, it does. There will be a patchwork of laws around the nation, either having abortion legal or illegal. Will we see some of the deaths and injuries that occurred pre-Roe when desperate women may have gone to back alley type abortions? I don't know. It will depend on how some of these abortion laws are structured.
We did have an inkling this was coming, the leaked draft opinion written by Justice Alito that came out in May, and we see some of that same language in this opinion. I want to quote, "We hold that Roe and Casey must be overruled. The Constitution makes no reference to abortion, and no such right is implicitly protected by any constitutional provision, including the one on which the defenders of Roe and Casey now chiefly rely. That provision has been held to guarantee some rights that are not mentioned in the Constitution, but any such right must be, quote, deeply rooted in this nation's history and tradition. And the right to abortion does not fall within this category." So explain what the Justice Alito was getting at there.
Judy, the conservative majority on this court approaches the Constitution and constitutional rights by looking at the text of the Constitution, tradition, and history. Justice Alito, in the abortion opinion, he said there was nothing in the text of the Constitution that supports an abortion right. There are many respected American historians who disagree and also challenge the ability of the court and judges in general to do the kind of historical research that is required to reach these kinds of conclusions.
So, Marcia, as we see, the Chief Justice, John Roberts, he does sign on to the majority opinion. But just quoting from what he wrote, he said, "If it is not necessary to decide more to dispose of a case, then it is necessary not to decide more. Surely we should adhere closely to principles of judicial restraint here, where the broader path the court chooses entails repudiating a constitutional right we have not only previously recognized, but also expressly reaffirmed, applying the doctrine of stare decisis." So what is the Chief Justice saying?
He wanted to only deal with the line that Roe and Casey drew about abortion bans, that you could not ban abortion before viability. That's at 22 to 24 weeks. He felt that that was not a clearly justified line. He's concerned about the court's legitimacy in making this ruling at this time. And he agreed with that part of the Alito majority opinion that did get rid of the viability line, but he would not, as you said, go so far as to overrule the entire Roe and Casey decisions.
And Marcia, as we know, there was a strongly worded dissent by the three liberal justices. Here is part of what they wrote in today's opinion. "But as a matter of constitutional substance, the majority's opinion has all the flaws its method would suggest, because laws in 1868 deprived women of any control over their bodies. The majority approves states doing so today. Today's decision strips women of agency over what even the majority agrees is a contested and contestable moral issue. It forces her to carry out the state's will, whatever the circumstances and whatever the harm it will wreak on her and her family. In the 14th Amendment's terms, it takes away her liberty."
Judy, the dissent had a lot of problems, obviously, with the majority opinion. First, the history. The point Justice Breyer, Kagan, and Sotomayor made very clearly was that the history that the majority relied upon, the laws at the time that they looked at, were all made by men. Women at the time did not have rights, basically any rights at all. So that was one flaw. The other flaw, very important flaw they felt, was that the majority failed to stand by old precedents, and that's known as stare decisis. The dissent felt the majority did not properly apply the factors that the court has generally applied when determining whether to overrule an earlier precedent, factors like reliance and workability. And so I think those were the two main takeaways. One other thing I would add about the majority opinion, Judy, that I think is kind of important, is that going forward, how will courts judge abortion regulations and restrictions? And the majority opinion says that all a state has to do is justify that regulation on by a rational, reasonable basis. And that is considered the easiest form of constitutional scrutiny.
So what does that mean for these state courts?
It means state and federal courts will be probably upholding many more abortion regulations and restrictions than they have done in the past.
Marcia Coyle, beginning to digest this most historic and significant decision handed down today by the Supreme Court. Marcia, thank you.
My pleasure, Judy.
We're going to hear from leaders on both sides of this issue about what comes next. First, I'm joined by Marjorie Dannenfelser. She's the president of the Susan B. Anthony Pro-Life America organization. Marjorie Dannenfelser, welcome to the NewsHour. So what is your reaction, the reaction of the anti-abortion movement? How much of a victory is this?
Well, for the pro-life movement, this is a culminating moment of 50 years of what we believe is the greatest human rights movement of our time. And every single abortion, there are two that must be served. And the experience of women since 1973, when they were told that this would be the great liberator, has not been that. It has been quite the opposite. And now that the states and the Congress, every elected body will be able to discuss this issue in the public square. The merits of the arguments will be meted out in ways that aren't closeted as the Supreme Court required all those 50 years ago. And the will of the people will make its way into the law, and women will be served in ways that they deserve.
I do want to ask you, because you told another reporter today, you said that you and others will work to ban abortion, and I'm quoting, in every state and in every legislature, including the Congress. So is your goal to ban abortion nationwide?
I think that if you look at what I said, you would see that I will work, and so will the pro-life movement, so will all the legislators, so will Democrats that don't like abortion after the first trimester, to work to be as ambitious as possible in every single legislature. That will be different state to state to state. North Carolina will be different from Alabama, will be different from Vermont and California. It means that the state law will reflect the will of those people.
We see, and you're aware of this, public opinion polls have been done by Pew. I mean, the NewsHour itself has commissioned polls in the last couple of months that show still that a majority of Americans thought that Roe should not be overturned, that most people believe American women should have a right to an abortion. So how does that public view square with what we're seeing today, do you think?
Judy, I have to believe that you have looked at the rest of those polls. When you look at the rest of those polls, you see that Democrats, women, diverse groups of people, this is not a partisan issue, think that abortion should at least be restricted in the second and third trimester. This seems reasonable to most people. Again, it doesn't please both sides, but it definitely is something that is a consensus in this nation. Doesn't reflect that poll bit that you just communicated. And it's because people want restrictions, people want limits that Roe simply would never have allowed, and that has not been understood.
I do want to ask you one other question, Marjorie Dannenfelser, and that is one that comes up from the anti-abortion movement, and that is the fundamental unfairness of saying to women who don't have the financial means who live in states where abortion will no longer be legal, that they are, in effect, either going to give birth to a child they are not prepared to give birth to, whereas women who have financial means are going to be able to travel somewhere if they want an abortion to get it. What about that?
Well, that would be unfair if that were true, but pro-life, not anti-abortion, is pro-life at birth and throughout life. And that is the commitment of the pro-life movement. It is my personal commitment, every leader that I know, and not just that small number of people, but the governors that I've spoken to, 22 so far, in the states that are most likely to limit abortion very early on. That commitment to those who are perceived as outliers, people who are perceived as can't manage allowing their children to be born, those are the people that we go to first. Those are the people that we love. Love is at the center of this movement, and it is exactly what makes us flourish and why we will succeed.
Marjorie Dannenfelser, thank you very much. The president of Susan B. Anthony Pro-Life America. We appreciate it.
Thank you.
And now to Alexis McGill Johnson. She is the president of the Planned Parenthood Action Fund. It's the political arm of the country's largest abortion provider. Alexis McGill Johnson, thank you very much for joining us. So what is your reaction to this historic decision?
Well, obviously, Judy, I'm devastated. You know, it is so challenging to have lost faith and hope in the institution that controls literally our bodies, our freedom. The fact that they came out with this decision, even though we saw a leaked version of it less than a month ago, it feels even harder to see it come to fruition.
What do you think the practical effect of it is going to be for American women, for American families?
The practical effect is that, you know, people will have to go to great lengths to get out of their states to get access to care. We know that 26 states are poised to ban access to abortion or severely restrict access. We know that 36 million women and non-binary and trans folk will be affected by this decision. We know that people who would be most impacted are likely to be low-income, rural, Black, Brown, Indigenous communities who may lack the resources to be able to get out of state. So it means that many people will be forced into pregnancy, and that will have a devastating consequence for the families they're currently caring for, much less themselves and their communities.
And what does it mean for Planned Parenthood and for other organizations like yours that support abortion rights? What do you do now?
Oh, look, I have lost hope in the court, but I have a lot of hope in the people. Now is the time for us to fight back. And that is exactly what we are planning to do. We are mobilizing people across the country to ensure that they know what is at stake, to ensure that every lawmaker, every corporation, every university understands the impact that this will have on their constituents, on their workforce, on their communities, on their students, and to ensure that no one gets to stay neutral in this moment. No one gets to say, well, that's a complicated, controversial issue I don't want to touch. When it starts to impact your community, you will have to take a stand, and we're going to force everyone who is in every community to have that conversation around what's at play right now.
And what about the effect politically? This is a midterm election year. What do you see happening now?
Look, I think President Biden said it today in his remarks to the country. Roe is on the ballot. This is going to be a driving force for millions of people to the polls. We know that people are devastated and outraged, and they should be, because the court just overturned 49 years of precedent. They just took away a right that we have been guaranteed and lived with for 49 years, and people are enraged. So we know that the midterm election is certainly going to be an incredibly important competitive set of elections in for every place from the Senate to the House to governor's races across the country and every state legislature.
The anti-abortion movement, many of its leaders are now saying they are not stopping with this. They are going to look now to try to ban abortion nationwide. How will you respond to that?
They've been forecasting this for so long. So we have to fight back and be just as relentless to fight their extremism. And that is exactly what we are going to do. Can you imagine in a state like New York or California when these laws start to encroach upon those freedoms? People will be riled up, and we know they will be out in the streets to fight back.
Alexis McGill-Johnson, the president of the Planned Parenthood Action Fund, thank you very much.
Thank you for having me.
In many ways, life in this country for people with unwanted pregnancies after today's reversal of Roe won't be quite the same as it was pre-1972. For one thing, medically induced abortions have now become the method that more than half of American women who end their pregnancies use. But for a generation of women who remember what life was like before Roe, they see far too many parallels to that era. Amna Nawaz has that part of the story.
It was just not something that any woman should have to go through, period. It's just as simple as that.
Decades ago, now 81-year-old Roberta Brandis Gratz was a reporter in New York City in her 20s when she had an unplanned pregnancy. She traveled to a clinic in Puerto Rico for what was then an illegal procedure in New York State and across much of America, an abortion.
It was the kind of hospital where women gave birth as well as had abortions. So you heard babies crying and you saw women who were there for the same reason you were. I had an anesthetic. It did not totally take. So it was partially painful. It was humiliating because I knew I was doing something illegal.
Before the 1973 Supreme Court decision Roe v. Wade, abortions were prohibited in 33 states and only allowed in special circumstances in 13 others. But women in those states still had abortions. Some through unsafe, so-called back alley procedures. Others tried to induce abortions themselves.
We had almost no options. You would either put yourself at risk by self-inflicting an abortion using knitting needles, crochet needles, anything that could stop, take big black pills. There was no other option that I knew anything about.
Billy Avery is a healthcare activist. She's been working on reproductive rights issues since 1971. At the time, women would also travel to terminate their pregnancies, abroad or to New York, where abortions were legalized in 1970. But Avery says that kind of travel just wasn't possible for many women she counseled in Florida, where the procedure was illegal in most cases.
A black woman came, and we started giving her this information. She said, I don't have any money to go to New York. I don't know anybody there. And about a month or two later, she died from a self-induced abortion. So that really opened my eyes that even if we had access to abortion, if women didn't have the means by which to pay for it, they still didn't really have access.
Throughout the 1950s and 1960s, an estimated 200,000 to 1.2 million illegal abortions were performed a year in the United States. Hundreds of women died every year from botched procedures. In the early 1960s, in New York City alone, abortion accounted for half of all childbirth-related deaths among non-white and Puerto Rican women.
Before Roe, there were septic abortion wards in hospitals of women who had tried to either induce their own abortion or went to someone who wasn't reliable, wasn't trustworthy, and had done damage to them.
As a graduate student in 1965, Heather Booth co-founded an underground abortion service in Chicago using a code name.
I said, we could use my phone, but change it so that they don't ask for Eleanor. How about Jane? Nobody's called Jane anymore.
We had the phone numbers on bulletin boards around Chicago. Pregnant, call Jane.
We
A new film, The Janes, airing on HBO and HBO Max, tells the story of those women who called themselves The Service. Between 1969 and 1973, using a network of secret communications and safe houses to protect each other and the women seeking help, The Janes performed thousands of safe and affordable abortions.
Women would launch into these stories. I have three children, I have no more money, my husband is leaving, or my husband is sick, or I don't have a husband, I'm 17, I want to go to college, and I've got this scholarship, and if I don't do this now... They were really cogent and important reasons, but we would really try to make clear to them they didn't have to justify themselves.
What we were trying to do was to create a caring community where there was a women's orientation of support, of helping women both through this decision and on with the rest of their life.
In 1972, the Chicago Police Department arrested seven members of the service and charged them with 11 counts of abortion and conspiracy to commit abortion. One of the Janes, Judith Arcana, remembers that day.
They took me out to the parking lot where they cuffed me, and then they took me into this van, you know, an ordinary police van, metal, cold. I was nervous. I was physically uncomfortable, literally shuddering from the cold.
Arcana was the first of the Janes to be let out on bail because she'd recently had a child and was still nursing.
What do you remember about going home to your baby after that?
I went and stood up. Maybe I have to cry. I went and stood next to his crib. And he woke up. And so I picked him up and nursed him. And while I was nursing him, I could feel the tension, which I had not even been conscious of, just streaming out of my body, mostly down my arms and legs.
A few months after their arrest, the Supreme Court legalized abortion nationwide. The charges against the Janes were dropped. Nearly 50 years on, the Supreme Court's decision to reverse Roe has left many activists who lived in an America before the landmark case devastated.
Women's lives will be thwarted. They'll be lessened. They'll be diminished because their freedoms are diminished. It means if you're raped, if you're a victim of incest, in many states, you won't have an option to have another direction in your life.
I think it's going to be worse for a lot of women. It's going to be worse for women who live on lower incomes.
Nevertheless, Avery believes, like in the days before Roe, women will find a way around restrictions.
This might seem like a step backward, but I think it's going to have a different kind of effect. It's an unjust law. And these young women are not going to take a back seat to anybody. They're going to do it. I have faith in them. They will, because their lives depend on it.
Back in New York, Gratz says getting her own illegal abortion motivated her to report on other women's abortion stories. And just months after the 1973 Roe v. Wade decision, she wrote a groundbreaking piece in Ms. Magazine, illustrated with a gruesome photo of a woman who died years earlier from a botched illegal abortion. The headline was Never Again.
It was entitled Never Again because, ironically, we thought never again would women have to go through what Jerry Santoro did, who was pictured in the photograph that accompanied the article, dead on a motel room floor. We thought never again. Who ever thought that the whole thing could be turned around?
But with the Supreme Court's decision, women now, again, contend with a world without Roe. I'm Amna Nawaz.
What's clear is that we are going to be dissecting this decision by the Supreme Court for months and years to come. Thank you for spending part of your evening with us on this important day. Tune in Saturday and Sunday to PBS News Weekend and online at pbs.org/newshour for the latest updates on the reaction and the impact of this historic decision. For those stations staying with us for Washington Week, Yamiche Alcindor is coming up next to discuss the political consequences of the ruling with her panel. For those stations going to other programming, I'll sign off. To all of you, thank you for watching. I'm Judy Woodruff. Have a good night. Washington Week starts in a few moments.
This program was made possible by contributions to your PBS station from viewers like you. Thank you.
Years of federal abortion rights ended.
I'm furious letting these people make decisions over